Good morning. My name is John Werner. I am the minister to men here at Portland Community Church, and I am delighted to be here, and I'm even more delighted to see your shining faces out there. So nice to be able to enjoy time worshiping together with our God. This morning, we are going to be in Luke chapter 17. Not chapter 19, but chapter 17. We're just looking at a few verses in there. And it's about designing your attitude and the impact that it has on your faith. Just to back up a half step, as Sam was praying this morning, collectively for all of us, he mentioned in his prayer that there's some scary stuff going on in our world. And there is indeed. We have had, even just yesterday, a radical Muslim attack in Afghanistan. Two people were killed, 17 were injured. The day before that, on the 1st of July, we had in Bangladesh, 22 people killed, 21 injured. The day before that, again in Afghanistan, we had 37 killed and 80 injured. The day before that, on the 29th of June, we had in Syria 10 killed, 25 injured. The day before that, in Turkey, we had 44 killed, and 239 injured. The day before that, on June 27th, in Yemen, we had 42 killed and 30 injured. In the last 30 days, just in the last 30 days, we've had Islamic terror attacks in 31 countries, 1,970 people killed, and over 1,800 people, in addition to that, injured. Scary times indeed. These folks are practicing their faith, their religion, and carrying it out in a very radical way. I've got a close friend who's a medical doctor, an OBGYN. And several times a year, he makes mission trips along with Medical Teams International to developing countries around the world. He's joined just as a part of a group of doctors who are, for the most part, all believers. And a number of years ago, he was on a trip to Egypt. And I've taught a number of classes this past week, and in one of those instances, I shared this this illustration, so if you've already heard it, you're going to hear it again, but I think it still really applies to what we're talking about this morning. My friend John was in Egypt with this Christian medical team of about 10 doctors. One of the doctors was a surgeon from England. Not all the doctors are U.S. They're from really all around the world. It's a large organization, does tremendously good work. And these doctors are guests in different houses. Hosts put them up, even when they can't well afford, because it's not an affluent country, to entertain guests, they are honored as a part of their Muslim faith to entertain and to host people who are from out of town. And even though they don't have a lot of money, many of these households have got household help. Maybe it's just a houseboy, maybe it's a maid who helps out around the house, and they work for next to nothing, but it's just a part of the culture there. Anyway, this English surgeon had been just there for only 2 days into a two-week trip when the houseboy stole his camera. Now, this is an expensive Nikon camera, top of the line, all the bells and whistles, the great big picture screen on the back, just remarkably good camera, you know, thousands of dollars that he had invested in this. And he had no sense of humor about this. And he grabs the kid and he says, "Look, give my camera back." And the kid protests, "Oh, I didn't take your camera." And the guy goes, "Look, I know you took my camera. I want you to give it back. If you give it back, I'm not going to say a word to anybody. Everything will be good. Just give me my camera back." And the boy wouldn't. He refused to give the camera back. So this British doctor goes to his host, the head of the household there, and he says, hey, look, I don't want to cause trouble, but I've got a very expensive camera that your houseboy has taken. I'd appreciate it if you'd go to him and tell him to give it back. I want my camera back. So the host goes to the houseboy and he says, give the man his camera back. How could you dishonor me? How could you dishonor our guest by taking something of his, by stealing from him? And the houseboy refused to do it. He claimed he hadn't taken it. So guess what happens? This is Sharia law. This is the Muslim faith. Do you know what the penalty is for stealing anything? Even things of not consequence? That very afternoon, that little houseboy is dragged out into the public square and his right hand is chopped off. Now, this British surgeon didn't realize what was going to happen by him lodging his complaint. He was appalled. Talk about cultural insensitivity. Now, he's a Christian, and he can't believe that this would happen anywhere in the world. Certainly not in a place where he is pouring out and offering his skills and his talent to better the community. Instead of healing, he's actually brought tremendous, permanent, lifelong damage to a young boy. This is a part of that culture. It's how those people live out their faith. Now, and you've got, there's just more examples of what's going on here in, as a part of Muslim radical attacks. I want to take a look at Luke chapter 17, but before I do, let me open us with a word of prayer. Father God, we thank you so much that you had your words, your conversation, written down for us in this book that we call the Bible. And Father, I pray that we would engage in a conversation, in a dialogue with you this morning. Lord, speak to us through your words. Help us, Father, to insert ourselves into the words that you are speaking through Luke chapter 17. We pray these things in the name of your Son, your only Son, Jesus. Amen. So, we do want to ask the question, and this is going to overarch the balance of our discussion, are faithful Muslims radical? Are faithful Muslims radical? It's an interesting question, and I'd like you to think about that through the filter of your own faith and the way that you approach your own faith and your beliefs. So, Luke 17, I'm going to read verses 7 through 10. And this is Jesus speaking, and he says, who among you would say to your slave who has just come in from plowing or tending sheep in the field, come here at once and take your place at the table? Would you not rather say to him, prepare supper for me, and put on your apron and serve me while I eat and drink, and later you may eat and drink? Do you thank the slave for doing what was commanded? So you also, when you've done all that you were ordered to do, say, we are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done. Now, whenever you read the Bible, whenever you study what it is that God's saying, it's helpful to ask yourself questions. That's a part of studying the Bible, of learning what God wants to say to us. This is a simple question. Who's the servant and who's the master? Well, who's Jesus speaking to? He's speaking to his disciples, but this is one of those rare instances in the Gospels where they're called apostles. It's sort of like they've been given the diploma before they've actually graduated. Because just a couple verses before that, it says, the apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith. And then Jesus goes on to talk about what we just read, as well as a couple of other things. So they're wanting to have their faith increased, but the servant is you. Specifically here, the disciples. Now, if you're a believer, you're a disciple. You may not be a practicing disciple. You may not read your Bible every morning. You may not pray every morning, but you are a believer. You feel strongly that Jesus is the Son of God, you've put your faith in him, that makes you a believer, it makes you a disciple. So that's who the servant is, and the master, of course, would be God. Now, these verses are a little bit insulting. Frankly, I would like to think that as a believer, as a disciple, that when I put a tithe in the offering bag, when it's passed down the pew, that would please God and God would pat me on the back. I would like to think that when I go to somebody to encourage them and tell them, hey, I'm praying for you, that God would pat me on the head. That's a good boy, John Werner. You're a good boy. And these verses say, hey, you know, you're supposed to do it because you're supposed to do it. You're not supposed to do it because you're expecting some sort of reward, because you're going to be moved to the head of the line, the head of the class, because you're going to look better than somebody else. That's not why we're supposed to do it. We're supposed to do it just because God's word tells us to do it. That's kind of hard to take. What is your attitude towards the master? Now, Jesus kind of frames this, and in this case, there's challenges that Jesus is putting to your faith. And I'm going to read just the first few verses of the same chapter because it sort of leads up to what we just read. And verse 1 of chapter 17, Jesus said to his disciples, occasions for stumbling are bound to come, but woe to anyone by whom they come. It would be better for you if a millstone were hung around your neck and you were thrown into the sea than for you to cause one of these little ones to stumble. Be on your guard. If another disciple sins, you must rebuke the offender. And if there's repentance, you must forgive. And if the same person sins against you 7 times a day and turns back to you 7 times and says, I repent, guess what? You must forgive. Now, what challenge is Jesus putting on your attitude of faith here? Well, I think the challenge here is it's kind of difficult. I mean, if you insult me 7 times in one day, I don't care if you ask for forgiveness 7 times, you're going to start to wear a little bit thin. It's going to be hard for me to take you seriously when you're saying, oh, I'm sorry, I was wrong. Please forgive me. It's difficult, not impossible, but difficult. Jesus wants us to kind of tuck that away. Now, we get to the verse 5. The apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith. And the Lord replies, if you had faith the size of a grain of mustard, a mustard seed, you'd say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it would obey you. Now, what challenge does Jesus put to your attitude of faith? Now, how many of you sitting there right now this morning honestly believe that if you prayed that the mulberry tree in your backyard should be uprooted and planted in the sea, that that would happen? Now, come on, be honest. Doesn't seem terribly likely, does it? I mean, I don't care if it's a mulberry tree or my wife's hydrangea bush, which I hate. I'd welcome that being planted in the sea. Or a dandelion in the middle of the front yard. Get up, be planted in the sea. I don't want you there. Is it going to happen? Jesus says if you have faith as the size of a grain of a mustard seed, it's one of the smallest seeds in nature. It's going to happen. That's what Jesus says. Well, that's a challenge to our faith. And I would say that that's one of those impossible challenges. I believe God could do it. Could I do it? The choice of words is perhaps not the right one, but not a prayer. I just don't see me having that strength of faith to cause that mulberry tree to get uprooted and planted in the sea. Now, the last verses, which are the first ones that we read, what challenge does Jesus put to your attitude of faith? He's talking about just doing your regular business. without looking for any kind of reward, without expecting a return. He's saying, you're supposed to prepare supper for the master. You're supposed to put on an apron and serve the master before you serve yourself. And this is after a long day in the hot fields working, tending sheep or planting crops, whatever it is that you're doing. You are supposed to have an attitude of, we're worthless servants. We've done only what was supposed to have been done. Now, what's your attitude towards your faith there? Well, this is those routine things. So we've got three things that are going on here. First, we've got Jesus giving us an example of faith that is difficult to pull off, an attitude. We've got Jesus giving us an example of an attitude towards faith that's just impossible. How in the world do we do that? In verses 5 and 6. And then finally, those first verses that we read, the very routine. And sometimes the very routine is the hardest part, the hardest to have a good attitude towards. You know, there's, back to the Muslims for just a second, part of their faith requires them to have a prayer rug handy and to unroll it. I can't remember if it's 4 or 5 times during the day. I think it's 5 times throughout the day. And they lay this prayer rug down facing east, facing towards Mecca, and they say their prayers. I mean, that's a routine thing. It's not difficult. It's not impossible. It's routine. But it's just wired into their DNA. It's a part of their attitude towards their faith. Now, I don't carry around a prayer rug, but even if I did, I have to tell you, I'm not so sure that when I showed up at Starbucks for a 7 a.m. meeting, that the first thing I would do before I meet with my friend is to roll out my symbolic imaginary prayer rug and face toward, wait just one second, I've got to face towards Mecca or face towards Jerusalem, and I've got to say my prayers, and I'm down on all fours. I mean, when was the last time you did that? And then you do it again mid-morning, and then you do it again at noon, and then you do it mid-afternoon, and then you do it the last thing in the afternoon. It doesn't matter where you are in the public forum. It's time for prayers. That's a part of your faith. That's what a Muslim's approach is, the routine. I don't practice my faith that way. I do pray during the day, but usually it's silently. It's inside my melon. I'm driving down the highway. I'm thinking about something, and I just offer up a prayer to God. But it's not a formal kind of thing, and it's certainly not a public display. Your faith is known by your attitude. Your faith is shown by your attitude. You can design your attitude. I'll give you an example. When my second child, I've got 3 kids, when my second child was born, my wife and I were underinsured. And we had to go out, we found out we had to go out of pocket over $1,000 for my little girl to be born. Now, what's your attitude when you've got a kid being born and you've got an expense that you're not prepared for? You don't say, oh, well, I guess we can't have the kid. Nah, that's not gonna happen. We were excited about our daughter being born. We didn't question it. You're going to have a baby. This is just, you just do it. You don't question it. You have the baby. We'll figure out how to pay for it after the fact. It'll take care of itself. Now, I relate this, and my wife related this to having a baby a number of years later. My uncle passed away, and he was a world-renowned artist. He sculpted, was commissioned to sculpt a statue of Leif Erikson for the entrance to the Seattle World's Fair decades ago, and it's still there today. He sculpted, he did a lot of sculpture, but he did was most known for his oil paintings, particularly of his seascapes. And I've been to his home any number of times up in Seattle, and he had a painting on the wall of his living room that absolutely took my breath away. It was just ocean and sky, no rocks, no boats, no people, just ocean and sky. And I'd sit there, and it was huge. I'd stare at that painting, and inside of just a minute, I'd feel wet. I could feel the spray from the ocean just enveloping me. I was just totally enthralled with this painting. Now, when my uncle died, my wife got in touch with the estate and arranged to buy for a Christmas present for me this painting. And it cost $1,500. That was what the estate was selling it for. Now, we didn't have $1,500 either. But as my wife shared with me at Christmas, when I opened up my package and was totally blown away, it's just like having a baby. You don't question this. You just have to do it. And we'll have to figure out how to pay for it. And she was right. This was a part of my heritage, my legacy. My blood had done this painting, had put it together. And it, by the way, still hanging in my living room today. And I love that painting. I feel that salt air every time I walk past it, which is several times a day. In both cases, our attitude was to go forward in faith. We had a joyful attitude, an attitude of expectancy. We didn't have the money to cover it, but we believed that God was going to take care of it. It's just one of those things. You don't question it. You just do it. You just do it. We were exercising our faith almost unconsciously, and God did provide. I'm here today. Otherwise, I'd be in a debtor's prison if he didn't. But isn't that kind of radical? Isn't that radical thinking that you could do something like that, that you could have a kid without having the money, or you could go and arrange to buy an expensive oil painting without having the money for it? It really is kind of a radical thing. Getting back to our Muslim friends, our faithful, I'm talking faithful, I'm not talking crazies, I'm not talking jihadists, but are faithful Muslims radical? Well, they roll out their prayer rugs 5 times a day and they pray towards Mecca. I mean, to me, that's kind of radical. They cut off this little houseboy's hand. I think that's kind of radical. But those are law-abiding citizens who are doing that. Now, this British surgeon and my friend John were finishing out their 2 weeks, and they're packing up for the trip home. And as this fellow from England is packing up his gear and he's pulling all his stuff together and he's pulling some stuff out from under the bed, there's his Nikon camera. This is incredible. He goes to his host, "Oh my gosh, this is a terrible thing. I found my camera. Your houseboy didn't take it. I had it all along. It was just where I had hidden it away so it would be safe." Do you know, the next day, they had that surgeon's right hand cut off. There's no appeal to the embassy. There's no trial. That's Sharia law. That's the Muslim faith. Now, because he was a guest in their country, they wanted to do him honor. So they had it done in a hospital, surgically, where he's all neatly stitched up. But here you've got a surgeon who's missing his right hand. He's lost his career. It's over. He thought he was there to do good. It's not just Sharia law. The book of Exodus says, you shall give eye for eye, tooth for tooth, hand for hand. You caused this houseboy's hand to be removed. You lose your hand. That's the law. And it's not just Muslim law. It's God's law. Wow. That's radical. That kind of reorients your thinking, doesn't it? Now, we don't practice things quite so draconian as that, but that is sort of the impetus behind what our faith should be, is to have a radical element. Now, you talk about radical Muslims. What about radical Christians? I don't see many in the United States. But you go to the Middle East, and this is a Muslim publication. It says, the people of the cross, the followers of the hostile Egyptian church. These are Coptic Christians from Egypt. And why are they called hostile? They're called hostile because they're not Muslim. And seconds after this picture is taken, every one of those 21 Coptic Christians is beheaded. Wow. That's scary. East versus West. We're not persecuted like that. We're not called upon to demonstrate this kind of radical attitude towards our faith. But if you are a Christian in the Middle East, you have to be radical to even just be a Christian. You've got to be really radical to go to church. It's forbidden. It's against the law. You have to be incredibly radical, just out of your head, crazy radical, to share your faith, your Christian faith, with a non-Christian. That's against the law as well. Now, in many Muslim countries, it's against the law to just be a Christian. In Egypt, it's not, as long as you're born a Christian. You can be born a Christian. You'll be persecuted. And I'm not just talking about getting shoved around on the playground in seventh grade. I'm talking about throughout your life, you're likely to suffer some persecution. But you can be born a Christian, and it's legal. You cannot become a Christian other than through birth. That's illegal. And you could be killed for becoming a Christian. You absolutely would be killed for trying to convert somebody to your way of thinking, to persuade a Muslim to become a believer. That's radical Christianity. These people, these believers, these Christians in Muslim countries have to have a radical faith if they have any faith at all. It's incredible. Would I do that? Would I have that kind of faith? Would you have that kind of faith? Do you have it, or do you even feel like you need to have it here in the United States? Now, we don't get persecuted per se like that, but I think there are challenges to our faith that many of us, myself included, just walk by and ignore. We don't roll out a symbolic prayer mat and pray in a public place. That would border on being radical. This little Muslim boy with the gun. Again, this is an Islamic propaganda piece. The Prophet said, and this is from the Quran, and by the way, I have to point out to you that Muslims hold Jesus in very high regard. He's mentioned over 100 times in the Quran, in glowing terms, but he's not regarded as the Son of God. He's not the Christ. So don't ever use the word Christ to a Muslim. But you can talk about Jesus all day long. They've got no quarrels with Jesus. He was a great prophet, or is to the Muslims, he is. But the Prophet, in this case, it would be the Prophet Muhammad, said, "None of you will have faith till he loves me more than his father, his children, and all mankind." Straight out of the Quran. Does that sound familiar? It's not that many weeks ago that Pastor Ron preached on almost the same text, except from the Gospel of Luke. "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters and even his own life, he cannot be my disciple." That's a pretty radical text. That's pretty radical. And it's not saying that you're supposed to hate mom and dad or your wife or your kids, but it's saying you're supposed to put Jesus before them, before all else. It's a radical concept. Do we do that? Do you really practice that? You know, I see instances in my own life all the time where I just can't be bothered. The routine just lulls me in to a sense of complacency, and I don't have any sense or feeling, let alone demonstrate, my faith, certainly not a radical faith. Is a faithful Muslim radical? The question I want to encourage you to ask yourself is your faith radical? Is your faith radical? Now, in designing your attitude, and our faith is driven by attitude. It's driven by attitude. I look back at the 22nd Psalm, which is the great messianic psalm, where it portrays all of the terrible things that Jesus is going through on the cross in graphic terms, hundreds upon hundreds of years before crucifixion was ever devised by the Romans. We have a very graphic description of it in Psalm 22. And it's a real downer until you get midway through that psalm when the psalmist who's describing crucifixion starts to praise God and his whole outlook changes. He demonstrates a radical attitude towards his situation and his whole frame of reference changes. It's really interesting. And then that from there launches into the 23rd Psalm, which is many of you are familiar with, "The Lord is my shepherd." How do we become radical in our faith? I would encourage you to think in terms of and challenge yourself, is my faith radical? And what steps could I take to become more radical, more demonstrative in my faith? How can I design my attitude? First step I would encourage all of us to is to engage in fellowship, not neglect fellowship, not neglect church. I get up on some Sunday mornings and I go, you know, I think I'm going to just blow it off today. I had too much fun yesterday at the beach. I partied too hard. The sun was really cooking. I got this nice tan, but you know that sun kind of takes it out of you, doesn't it? Sort of makes you a little bit tired. It sort of drains the strength. I think I'm just going to stay home today. You know, there's some good sports going on TV. I think I'll just do that. Or my wife arranges for us to have a dinner with some friends on Thursday night, some believers, and we're going to get together and talk about something that we're working on together at church. And Thursday night comes, and I've had a long day at work, and it's just, you know, I'm not going to go. I just can't be bothered. You go ahead. You go ahead. I'm not going to go. Hebrews 10, 24 and 25 says, let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good works. That's a pretty radical thing, isn't it? Provoke. Not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. God wants us to be in fellowship with each other. It's a part of changing our attitude towards our faith. Provoking one another to love and good works is radical. It really is. You know, a second thing that we can do is tithing. Now, we talk about tithing. The book of Malachi says, put me to the test, says the Lord of hosts. See if I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you an overflowing blessing. God wants you to participate in worship. And a part of the act of worship is tithing, returning to God just a small portion of what he has blessed you with. That's demonstrating a radical attitude towards your faith. You know, there's a lot of people who say, I can't believe you give money out of your paycheck every week to church. Why in the world do you do that? Couldn't you use that money elsewhere? I mean, you got a car payment there, you got a house payment, you've got stuff that you've been saving away for. Why do you give money to your church? That's really radical. But it's something that God honors and God blesses. A third thing of four is study. Psalm 119 says, thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against God. Thy word is a light unto my path. God wants us not just to read his word, but to study it. When you open up this Bible, ask yourself questions. Insert yourself into the dialogue. Put your name right there in place of one of the characters' names. And see how it addresses your relationship with God. Studying God's word is radical. When I used to work for a public company, publicly held company, I don't have the gift of evangelism, but I would make it a practice of putting my Bible on the corner of my desk. And I'd have people come into my office and they'd look at this Bible, and it's very obviously a Bible. Sometimes it would be open with little red underlines or yellow highlights here or there. And they'd look at it and they'd kind of scratch their head and they go, "Do you read this?" "Well, yeah, I do." And that might be all the more I would ever share about my faith. But studying my Bible is important to me. It is very important to me, and I would love for it to be just as important or more so to you. That's how we get to know God. That is what creates a radical attitude towards our faith. And then finally, pray. The Bible says pray without ceasing. That's the dialogue with God. You know, Jesus identified himself more than any other name as the Son of Man. Now he referred to himself as the Son of David, and some other names, but he seemed to just love the title, the Son of Man. Why was that? Because he's identifying with you. He has set aside his godly attributes and exchanged them for flesh and blood just like you. He gets tired. He gets thirsty. He gets hungry. He doesn't have enough knowledge. It says when Jesus learned, he did this, and then he went on. So he learns. Jesus is the Son of Man, but he recognizes the need to pray. That's what his source of power was. There's all kinds of instances in the Gospels where it says Jesus went off to the hills to pray by himself. Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Jesus was a man of prayer. That's what his source of power was, because he's the Son of Man, and absent that connection with his Father, he wouldn't have been able to do these miracles. He wouldn't have been able to figure out what this individual is up to, or what that person was thinking, or what that Pharisee was about to say. That comes from his prayer connection to his Father in heaven. And that's the same power that's available to us and would give us the ability to redesign our attitude of faith, to become a radical person of faith, to say to that mulberry tree, pick yourself up and go plant yourself in the sea. That's what Jesus wants to make available to us. I would encourage all of us, as we consider these words from Luke's gospel, to take on some radical aspects to our faith, to be willing to be radical for the sake of our God. We're not talking about going out and killing anybody. We're just talking about being willing to stick out like a sore thumb and saying, this is what my relationship to God means to me. And in all of this, what Jesus is calling us to is exactly that, a closer relationship to God. God loves you. He wants to unleash his power in you, not just in your heart, but in your life. He wants you to take a radical approach towards designing your attitude and your faith. Let me close this in a word of prayer. Father God, we thank you for these words. And I pray, Lord, that you would help us to not just to consider how to provoke one another to love and good works, but to provoke ourselves. Lord, I pray that you would help us to be people who would take a radical approach to our faith and to consider what that means in our life. Thank you for each individual here, and I ask, Lord, a special blessing on them today. We pray these things in the name of your Son, your only Son, Jesus. Amen.